so much. It's great to be here, especially a couple days after a midterm election that I'm sure most of us in our lifetimes have not, you know, there isn't that much emphasis on midterms. And this year, it seems like Trump was right when he said it was like the hottest thing. And so, you know, how it'll affect democracy, I think that's something that we can talk about. So I just want to introduce our panelists. Liz Hempowitz is the Director of Public Policy at the Project on Government Oversight, also known as POGO. A lot of people get her emails and POGO's emails. She oversees legislative reform work for the network with a focus on whistleblower protections and government accountability. To her left is Soren Dayton. He's the Director of Communications for and Policy at Protect Democracy, which is a nonprofit advocacy group that seeks to strengthen, you know, the institutions of democracy. To his left is Meredith McGehee, who serves as the Executive Director of Issue One, where she leads advocacy efforts on a broad range of political reform measures, such as keeping foreign interference out of our elections, to overhauling the really troubled FEC, and to many other important ethics oversight in Congress. And our final panelist is James Wallner, who's a senior fellow at the R Street Institute. So you're our house guest here. And he's a member of R Street's governance project and legislative branch capacity working group teams. What does that mean? That's a really long team name.
We want to help the legislative branch work on it.
Good. As do we all. So I thought I would just kick it off with some questions to, you know, some of our panelists. I wanted to start with Soren, since we had the elections and a couple of days ago. You know, your organization is all about protecting the institutions of democracy. Mm-hmm. A lot of people were concerned when President Trump took office that democracy would kind of see the decline. So David Frum, he wrote a cover story in The Atlantic about the decline of democracy, and a lot of liberals were frankly freaking out. Now that we're almost 2 years in, do you think people overreacted, or what do you think of, you know, it seems like we still have a free press, we still have, you know, Congress. Trump did not dispute the midterm election results, even though he could have claimed voter fraud. Like, do people overreact when Trump was first elected to your issues?
So I think it's helpful to step back, because when you know, yes, this discussion happened among Democrats and liberals, but if you look at the people that have been doing analytic work on American democracy, so Freedom House, founded after World War II by a bunch of Cold Warriors and staffed by Cold Warriors, they've been downgrading American democracy for the last 7 years. In their 2018 report, you know, they said there's been a sharp downward decline that has accelerated under Trump, but is not necessarily about Trump in itself. So I don't know if people saw on Monday afternoon, a great time to release an in-depth piece on Congress. Paul Kane and Derek Willis had a piece at the Post about the collapse of congressional oversight. In the Senate, oversight hearings are down by 7/8 from the 70s. In the House, almost 3/4. So that's a case where institutions not working has been absolutely magnified over time. And these are things you can correlate. And there's plenty of other examples that we're working on, vacancies that, you know, something I know is close to Liz's heart, that sort of follow this path as our institutions are gradually degrading. I don't think it's always the sort of sexy thing of the day that's in the news cycle.
But do you think people overreacted?
No,
you don't.
Absolutely not.
And what about, you know, what are some, like, some of the reforms that the new Congress should tackle that you think deserve more attention, that could actually help in bumping us up on the Freedom House rankings?
So I think the key question is going to be, what kind of oversight is going to happen? Is it going to be political oversight that says, you know, that's just going after people, which isn't necessarily a bad thing? I mean, there's plenty of good, grounded political hatchet work in Washington. A bunch of us have made our living doing that. But are we going to focus on things that are of long-term consequence? Like, you know, how does Congress get its capacity back? You know, how sort of what do we do about things like vacancies and how we fill jobs in the executive branch, or is it just going to be politics? And I think that's really what today is about. And if Congress can lay the table for future reforms with oversight, then I think we're in a good spot. And that's really how Tuesday could be a really good day for American democracy.
Question for Liz. Like, Trump said yesterday that he's going to adopt a warlike stance, which is not something you usually hear from a president talking about another branch of government, in terms of how the House is going to investigate him. You know, to what extent is the coming conflict between the House Democrats and the executive branch, is that, and the investigative oversight between the two branches, is that something, you know, how much did the founders, you know, think that this type of huge battle royale would happen? Is, you know, just, I guess Trump has not really studied the founders that much, but like, what, how would you answer that?
Yeah, well, I don't think that kind of rhetoric from the president is helpful at all. It's also not really new. I think there's an inherent tension between any oversight body and the entity that it's supposed to be overseeing. So there always has been this tension between Congress and the executive branch. It's not new either. You know, last Congress we saw in May of 2017, the Office of Legal Counsel of the Department of Justice issued an opinion that said individual members of Congress are not authorized to conduct oversight, and therefore when they send information requests to agencies, they are only entitled to the review of as if that request was coming from a member of the public. And that's building off of a memo or an opinion that was released in 1984 by the Office of Information Policy that it basically interpreted the Freedom of Information Act so narrowly to say that agencies could just treat any request from members of Congress as if they were coming from an individual and responsive to a FOIA request. And so members of Congress for decades have been getting back information from agencies with redactions that are meant for the public, not for the overseers who are supposed to know everything that's going on at an agency. And so I don't think it's new. I don't think it's helpful that the president says that. You know, I think I was talking to some reporters yesterday, and I made the remark that I think it's interesting that everybody's immediately going to subpoena power, that Democrats now have subpoena power and they can force compliance. And I think it's because we've now normalized the idea that the executive branch is going to push back and not cooperate with Congress, whether or not it's the party, same party in power. But then I saw the president's remarks from yesterday, and I understand exactly why people are immediately going to subpoena power. He's essentially saying, we're not going to cooperate with you, and if you investigate the executive branch, then I'm not even going to cooperate with you on legislation. And then you have the leader of the Senate, you know, Mitch McConnell, calling it presidential harassment instead of what it is, which is oversight, and that's the job of Congress. And so I think it's not just the president who's fueling this rhetoric. It's not new, but it is problematic, and I think everybody in this community should be worried about it.
Does the, you mentioned FOIA, as a reporter, and I'm sure people in this audience have also, you know, FOIA'd government agencies, why is the process so broken? Is it a matter of just, you know, is can Congress do something to, like, you know, increase the FOIA examiners, or like, why does it take, you know, a year and a half for me to get schedules from the first quarter? You know, what I did was, my colleague and I, we thought to ourselves, well, we should FOIA all of the cabinet members' schedules for the first quarter of the administration for those 3 months to see, are they meeting with, you know, business leaders more or lobbyists? Like, there must be something interesting in it. And so we made that request the first 100 days, and that only in the last couple months have I gotten, you know, stuff back, which is just like, these are the public servants. And so why is FOIA so broken?
Like, what can we do? We could have a whole panel on that. So I'll try to answer that as short as possible. I think to your question, can Congress fix FOIA? Absolutely. Congress, you know, every 7 years or so, they're on a very good clock. Members of Congress update FOIA, and the last round was at the end of 2016, I believe. So we are not scheduled for FOIA reform for another few years, but members of Congress obviously don't need to stick to that timetable. But I think a few of the main problems right now is a lack of resources. And then I also think members of Congress need to, that FOIA, that Office of Information information policy memo I mentioned earlier, members of Congress have the ability to clarify that that's not what FOIA means, that members of Congress are not subject to those same redactions. And we've been working on getting Congress to update that for decades. And there hasn't been this appetite to kind of push back on the executive branch saying, no, you can't have this information from members of Congress. And it's infuriating as an outside advocate that I feel like our community stands up for Congress more than Congress stands up for itself. But yeah, I think one of the main problems is that there's a lack of resources for FOIA. You mentioned the time delay between your request and when you got it. And there's a statutorily mandated time frame of 20 business days, and then 10 days if there's exigent circumstances. No agency is following that, and there are no consequences for that. Right now we're hearing from FOIA officers that we need to sue, instead of going through the agency appeal process, that we need to sue in court to get records or to be like bumped to the front of the line, and that's not how it's supposed to work. I think, what Soren mentioned, that there's kind of been this breakdown of oversight. I think this is a major area that Congress can be asking questions. They can be figuring out exactly what is the slowdown. Why do people have to go to court now to enforce the law that says you are entitled to this information in this amount of time? I think Congress is kind of dropping the ball on that issue. And it's an area that we've seen bipartisan support and cooperation historically. And so I think the fact that there haven't been many oversight hearings over FOIA and how the changes have been the changes to the law were being implemented over the last 2 years is a really great indication that Congress is focused on other things right now.
So James, you know Jeff Sessions, since you worked for him earlier in your career. Now that he was basically told to resign yesterday after being grilled over Twitter for last year and a half, now that he's out of a job, what do you think he's going to do next? Are you going to try to recruit him to our street? Like, would he fit into the workplace culture here?
First, let me say that working for Jeff Sessions is a great honor. He's a great man, regardless of if you agree or disagree with his views on certain policies. He is committed to the rule of law. And I think one of the reasons why he hung on for so long is AG. One of the reasons why he stuck around was precisely because he was worried about what would happen at the Department of Justice after he left. And so I think that he's a public servant, and he's an old-fashioned kind of guy, and he loves the rule of law. And that's something he believes deeply in, and I think we should all thank him for that, regardless, again, of how you agree or disagree on the various policies that he has. I don't know what he's going to do.
We had a story in Politico. He might run for his old seat.
we'll see. He's been at this for a very long time. He's been in the public realm for a very long time, and it's unclear he'll want to retire or if he wants to get back in. I don't know.
Do you think his time as AG and the fact that his Trump's attacks on him have they overshadowed his legacy in the Senate that you mentioned? It doesn't seem like most people in America, they will think of Jeff Sessions as their attorney general who had the worst relationship with his boss that a cabinet member had in decades, probably. Do you think that will make it hard for the public to recognize what you say is Sessions' legacy in the Senate?
I mean, he's always been a lower profile kind of member. He always was. I don't think that even if he wasn't AG, that he would rise to the top of most people's list of extraordinary senators. I think he was an exemplar of the institution. He was committed to it. He's a committed institutionalist, and he worked across the aisle when he found things that he agreed on, and he worked as a partisan warrior when he didn't. And I think those things aren't mutually exclusive. And he saw the Senate as a place where Americans came together on the basis of equality and battled out their differences. And I think we need more of that there, not less.
Meredith, I wanted to bring you in. You've been working on these issues for a while. You cut your teeth on the Keating Five, which some people might not even remember who was the other four in that Keating Five. Since freshman orientation is next week for members of Congress, there's going to be a lot of members who don't have their traditional ties to business, aka K Street. Some people said they wouldn't take money from corporate PACs. But it feels like every couple of years you have these members and then they get swallowed by the swamp. Do you expect that with the more important small dollar donations having fueled a lot of these campaigns, that do you see any ways that this is going to be, do you expect this to be different, or are we kind of like stuck in every, you know, you bring in new members and they just get corrupted over the
Well, a couple things on that. We are going to see a very large number of new members, and I actually think that's very healthy. That's kind of what, for the people that are big fans of term limits, I already say we have term limits. You know, the issue here is whether you have competitive elections. Very different question, right? So I think it's very healthy that we're going to have a fairly large turnover, either from the people that voluntarily retired or from the people that won and lost and come in. And that's not a partisan issue. That's just a healthy democracy. We were having this question a long time ago when I started going into this kind of work on the outside. I had worked on the Hill for 6 years. I had a friend that I made, and he asked me, you know, why are you going to work in this kind of nonprofit sector? I mean, you know, why don't you come out with me and, you know, we'll just elect the good people so that when they get there, you don't have to lobby them.
Like Mr. Smith comes to Washington.
Yeah, you know, so if we just elect the good people, then there's no need for you. I've been a registered lobbyist since 1987, trying to get people to do what I think are the right things. But if you just like the right people, then you don't have to lobby them. Let me tell you how wrong that is. And that's one of the reasons I've stayed in this work. I think it's one of the reasons that the work of Issue One, I think, is so important, is the system, and I don't mean that it's kind of, you know, it's like with the big S, but the reality is when people get into political office and come to Washington, they do, in fact, get changed by the system. The system changes, and it's almost impossible to resist. The people that resist end up leaving. I'm going to actually mention a name here, which is often you don't do, right, in Washington. But I'm going to mention Mike Gallagher, young Marine, former Marine, as they say, always a Marine, never, you know, never an ex-Marine, always a Marine. He went to Princeton, speaks Arabic, Republican from Green Bay, and came in here very gung-ho, he is a Marine, right, and about how he wanted the system, but he got here and it was things like, I'm spending way too much time fundraising, I'm spending way too much time not having choices about what I get to vote on, I'm spending way too much time having my leadership tell me kind of what's going to get to be voted on. The things I do get to kind of put my imprimatur on, I don't really get a chance to move. And, you know, he's publicly stated numerous times that either the system changes, but or he's gonna leave. He's not going to come and be here for the next 30 or 40 years waiting on that chance that he can move up the ladder. And the irony is, this is kind of the old Washington, right, where you get here, be seen and not heard at first, wait a few years, make your maiden speech then, and become more effective, and then you go up the ladder and you become a committee chair, a subcommittee chair, a committee chair, maybe at some point in the leadership, and then at some point maybe speaker. Well, look what happened to our last two speakers. They voluntarily stepped aside. So when we're having this discussion about what's wrong with the institution, I've heard some people say, oh, well, you know, the speaker and the leader are too powerful. I've never known anyone in history who has voluntarily stepped down because they were too powerful. I just can't handle the power. That's just not real. The reason that the speaker and John Boehner and Paul Ryan have stepped down is that the body is dysfunctional. And I will tell you that the reason there is great dissatisfaction in the rank and file is that, I don't think there's probably a better way to say it, the job sucks. You know, so when we look at the new people coming in, they want to be relevant. They want to have an opportunity to represent their constituency. And I think this is the core kind of concept here as we think about the 116th, is the people coming in, will they have an opportunity to actually be a representative? Or will the swamp, being the swamp, always the swamp, kind of just start, you know, it's like when it gets on your feet and it just starts like one of those old, you know, shows, it just starts coming. It's at your neck. It's really hard to avoid that. And some of it's the role of money. Some of it's the nature of Congress abdicating its constitutional responsibility. Some of it, I think, is a generational tug of war that's happening right now between the geriatric set, I'll put that somewhat mildly, that is in control of much of Washington, versus a generational change, and you know, people don't let go again of those powers. So I'm actually very kind of encouraged to see what the 116th is going to look like. I'll just say one of the things, as we were talking a little bit before the panel started, about, you know, policy versus politics and whatever, and just kind of how a lot of people, when I go home to New Mexico, will say, oh, God, I hate politics. And I'm like, you guys, if you've ever lived anywhere, which I have as a Peace Corps volunteer back in the day, where they don't get to do politics, you love politics. Because politics is the way that you resolve your problems peacefully. Doesn't mean conflict doesn't exist, right? Politics and democracy, at the heart of it is that there's conflict. We're human beings. James and I were talking, marriage, there's conflict, right? This is human beings. The question is, how do you resolve that? And do you resolve that through peaceful negotiations? Hopefully in marriage, that's what you do. Do you resolve it through compromise? Absolutely, you do. That's what politics is. So you can't have freedom from politics, particularly if you want to have a democracy.
The what you were saying about members complaining, like Mike Gallagher, about raise so much money, it reminds me of, you know, members often tell us how miserable it is to kind of just be, you're elected to be a beggar for 2 hours a day, every day. You have to beg for money.
Or four.
I remember one senator once joked to me that how, you know, when she was running for, you know, office or re-election, she called all her old boyfriends, the people who were her hometown boyfriends, who are now doctors and lawyers. And so, you know, just imagine that is probably the case for a lot. I think a lot of, you know, boyfriends and girlfriends, the old exes, have been called by these members saying, you know, I haven't stayed in touch with you, but I really could use that, you know, $2,700. Are there any proposals or bills that, I know there's no silver bullet, but are there any things that have been introduced in the last 2 years that you think could actually have a chance of passing or make a real difference in trying to reduce the, you know, the amount of money in politics, or just how you are, a lot of congressmen are overly reliant on, you know, lobbyists and, you know, yeah, fundraisers at Aqua Aldue and things like that.
Yeah, actually, there's kind of a lot going on in that, but I think you have to start from Citizens United simply because it changed 100 years of jurisprudence. And after that ruling by the court, I would say that the partisan breakdown of the discussion about what the role that money should play in their elections kind of exploded or imploded, whichever way you want to look at it. We spent a lot of time actually trying to take those pieces and kind of put it back together a little bit again. There are some people, oh, you can't do anything. And you know, there's a lot you can do. There's a lot that can be done post Citizens United. The question is partly how you define what the problem is. So I know if you go on the Hill, members say the problem is I'm spending all my time as a telemarketer, dialing for dollars. So from a member's perspective, that's it. I've also heard from members that the problem is one day they're going and they're at a markup to do a bill, and then that night they're going to the PAC fundraiser or the other fundraiser by that same industry.
Like UPS has their own Hill House,
right,
which is, so, you know.
But that this close nexus in time between their action as a lawmaker on a bill, and then going that same day to the entity that's going to be affected by that legislative action. So they talk about that. I think if you talk to people, they have a very different, most American people, which is, I don't feel like my voice is heard. I feel like, you know, that the whether it's Steyer on one side or Koch on the other, they have too much sway. So these are the conversations when you talk up here that you kind of have, and it guides you down different paths. We know the one thing that every member of Congress, I think, that we've talked to hates is dark money, because they don't know where it's coming from. They don't know how to prepare for it. I can now say another name, Joe Donnelly. We were in a conversation with him more than a year and a half ago, in which we were talking about legislation. He introduced a bill to reform the Federal Election Commission. If you don't have good enforcement, no matter what the law is on the books, the law won't work. But he said, I'm going to spend all my time for the next year and a half raising money. And I know that at some point, some unknown group is going to come in and basically wipe out almost any advantage I have, even as an incumbent. And he lost. Now, I don't know that that was a money question, but it was his perspective on the system. There's a lot of things that can be done, and one of the conversations we're having, the FEC reform bill, bipartisan legislation, to actually try and make this agency work. We have legislation dealing with the role of disclosure for ads on Facebook and Google. That's a bipartisan bill, the Honest Ads Act. We have legislation we've been working on foreign interference, so that it's called the EPIC Act that Mr. Kilmer has put in. So there's a lot of things that can be done. As somebody who's worked on these issues for so many years, there is no magic bullet, and I get very impatient with anyone who says there is, because the politics and humanity and, it's just much more complicated than that. People, this is not, let me be very clear in this audience, the discussion here is not about getting money out of politics. I think that is, to me, that's an irrational conversation. It's about where does the money come from, what are the sources of the money, what is the effect on our policymakers and our politicians, and how do you get this balance in a democracy when we have a capitalistic system and a one person, one vote? How do you get the right balance between the role that should play? How do you ensure voices are heard? These are much bigger and more complicated questions simply than, let's get all money out of politics.
We're going to go to audience questions in 1 second, but I wanted to ask James, so think of some good questions. I wanted to ask James, you tweeted this morning, and we had talked about it last night. I'm not going to expose you under. You said deep divisions everywhere. You were linked into a Washington Post article. Deep divisions everywhere, but in Congress, the one place in government where Americans are meant to come together and resolve their differences. If past is any indication, both parties remain united in their aversion to political conflict in House and Senate. Can you explain that? It's like, aren't we seeing tons of political conflicts over, the last couple of years and what House Democrats have promised for the next Congress?
Sure, I think we see lots of conflict wherever we look. And when I tell people we need more conflict in our politics, they look at me like I have like 10 heads on my body. But if you think about it and step back, where does that conflict occur? It's not really occurring in the House and the Senate, right? And it's occurring on the campaign trail. It's occurring out in the media. It's a politics of scandal. It can be legitimate or not, but it's not what Congress is supposed to do. Congress is a crucible of conflict. It adjudicates the concerns of the American people. That's literally its purpose. It also investigates and does other things, but at the end of the day, that's it. And the members don't do that. You see Schumer yesterday argue with the president over who won the election, as if that matters, right? I mean, it's over. Now, you have, presumably, the 116th Congress. You then act, right? But the problem in our politics today, as I see it in Congress, is that there is no action. It's inaction, and that's what gridlock is. Gridlock is the absence of action. There's no action on DACA, even though so far as I can tell, like literally everyone seems to agree that it should be codified in some form. The question is, well, what goes along with it? Well, that's something that only a debate can resolve. If they don't act, they say, let's let the courts decide, let's let the administration decide, because they're divided on it. So you have both parties try to avoid these divisions, their internal divisions, so that they project this unity that we then interpret on the outside as this polarization. And the only way to resolve it is to win, right? To win these elections. And if you ask yourself, especially in the Senate, what's really going to change? What can the Democrats not do in the 116th that they could do in the 150th? No, it's the same thing. What can Republicans do in the 116th that they could not do in the 150th?
So what would you do to encourage more conflict? Or how do you, besides just, rhetorically, like, is there any policy changes, or is it just kind of a matter of shifting our politics to encourage more vigorous debate in Congress during a legislative session?
I think first and foremost, it's in all of us. We have to start seeing conflict as a good thing. It's the whole point of politics, as Trent says. If you don't have conflict, you don't need politics. And
you don't want to be like a one-party state like North Korea.
Right. We don't see politics as, many of us do now, but we don't see politics as a way to impose our truth on the world. That's not the point of politics. It's to compromise with your equals and then to figure out how to make common decisions. And out of that, that's what happened. And if we, until we change the way we see things, nothing is going to change. And I think it's odd that you have constituents and activists who are getting more and more frustrated that nothing ever seems to change in the House and the Senate. The party's never really acting differently. And they just blame the other. And so I think you see this all the time. And yesterday, McConnell said, well, now they're never going to repeal Obamacare, the Affordable Care Act, because the Democrats are in control of the House, as if that is the reason why the Republicans were able to do that. I mean, this is ridiculous. I mean, this is silly, right? But what members of Congress do is they always deflect blame when expectations turn out, where things turn out differently than they led people to expect. And then they simultaneously claim credit for the fact that they were worse. So you have McConnell saying this is the most historic obstruction that any Congress has ever experienced, but it's also the best Congress ever. In the same breath. And nobody notices it. We just pick up on it and we run with it because it's easier to just explain the world in these terms. And what happens is the reality that we see in front of us is not what we think it is. We are not as polarized as we think we are. There, the divisions are not zero sum. They're not existential. This is not 1858, right? Fights over the top marginal tax rate are not fights over slavery. I mean, this is ridiculous. But until we recognize that, we're never going to be able to do politics. And politics is going to say, that's the point. It's not a bad thing. It's a good thing.
So love to take any audience Q&A. Try to keep it to a question and introduce yourself, if you don't mind, and point to the panelists you're most interested in.
Forceful or seven. I'm Charlie Clark, Puerto Rico. I noticed the elections, even though they're really as they were kind of nationalized, they were so why is it that they're still possible in Florida? I mean in Georgia and Kansas had secondary elections and so but is there any federal way to expose that?
So we actually have a lawsuit in Georgia. Over this, there's a hearing, I think, as we speak. Well, it was started at 9:30. I don't know the status. I've been here. The question of whether there's a federal way, certainly the court could say, and we've asked for a temporary restraining order saying that Kemp has gone too far. He's not acting as an adjudicator. He's acting in a different way, but that is not, so the court says, there could be a scenario where the federal government could pass legislation saying if federal questions are on the ballot that's not possible, or that can't be done, it has to be run by somebody else, and that would probably have a substantial effect. But I don't think that legislation has been introduced by anyone, although it wouldn't surprise me if it happened in the next Congress. Happy to get you details.
Something to say about this. What do you think the likelihood is of any kind of cooperation? I'm thinking one of the things that I don't know about that when Trump first came into office was that it's a wild traditional Republican. There might be a deal with Chuck and Nancy at some point, as he put it, that it seems to happen. So now that the House is really Democratic, is there going to be kind of a part about the fact that is there going to be something where people can see eye to eye, would we be able to see President Trump, the deal maker, across the aisle, or is that true?
I think there's a number of issues that cooperation can exist, criminal justice reform, transportation, right? Those are big ones. But it's not just those. Think about the most controversial issues that the Americans are most concerned about right now. Healthcare, immigration, guns, things like that, right? These are also the issues that Congress goes out of their way to avoid. Mm-hmm. And the reason why, I think, is because the parties don't agree with each other internally on these issues. Mm-hmm. That tells me that there is grounds for compromise. I may not like what comes out of it, but last time I checked, the Constitution isn't designed to give James Waller what he wants. That's not the point. My goal is to fight as hard as I can within that, if I'm within Congress, to try to make sure the outcome is what I want it to be, or close to it, and to persuade my colleagues of it. But I'm not guaranteed to win, right? And I shouldn't approach it in that way. But there's a political scientist in the 1950s named Bertrand Gross. He was a scholar practitioner. And he wrote a book called The Legislative Struggle. And there's a great observation in this book. Compromise emerges out of the struggle. We've lost sight of that. If you don't have a process, if you don't have a struggle, if you don't have a debate, there is no compromise. The Civil Rights Act of 1964 didn't fall down out of the sky. It didn't come down from on high and land on Mount Sinai and said, here I am. It emerged out of the struggle. But we have members, and we ourselves are unwilling to tolerate the struggle, so it should come as no surprise that we don't have big things.
And I say 3 points. One is, if you kind of don't look behind the curtain, right, as some people say in the land of Oz that they don't want you to do, there's actually been great, in this election, an area of a remarkable agreement. And believe it or not, it's on healthcare. When I see ads by Republicans talking about covering pre-existing conditions, guess what? That was people coming together. Don't use the words Obamacare or Affordable Care Act, but there is actually now red states that passed Medicaid extensions. You know, and this, so there's actually much more consensus on healthcare in the country than anybody in Washington wants to recognize. I think there's probably opportunities for some compromises or some agreements on infrastructure. You know, this is something Obama talked about. This is something that President Trump has talked about, and that most members of Congress love because they get votes for it. And then I'd say there's a third area where it, to me, just jumps out automatically, and that is in this question about the functioning of Congress. There is a group that has been meeting for the last several months, led by Ken Buck, a very conservative Republican from Colorado, Derek Kilmer, moderate Democrat from Washington. They just had an op-ed in one of the campus publications about this work to try and make the House more functional. You know, the problem solvers, you know, had their proposals out there. It was bipartisan. So there is a lot of discussion, at least in the House, about how to make the institution work better. I think you're going to find that there is some ability and some agreement to try and figure out how to do that. I think the Democrats will take on some of that at the beginning, but there's interest in that. Open question about whether there'll be any interest in the Senate. I can't quite figure out the logic why Mitch McConnell would want to embrace that. But still, I think in those are like three areas, to me, off the top is, you know, there's great money in just the fact of continuing to have conflict to be the story. And there's a lot of people in Washington, there's kind of like a whole class, whether you're a consultant, whether you're an ad buyer, whether you're a political operative, that wants to keep this going. I mean, this is what President Trump has figured out. I mean, it's kind of like, guys, come on. What he has figured out is, if he can keep the attention on him, if he can kind of keep the pot boiling, right, this works for the kind of politics that he wants to do. So, you know, you have to kind of understand in the political world that there's really not a whole, it's like marketing something. There's not a whole lot, you know, selling vanilla doesn't sell that well.
There's some congressmen that are talking about bringing back earmarks, and Trump, you know, doesn't seem to be that opposed to that. Last time we had earmarks, there was, you know, they were seen as more corrupt, and that, you know, people, companies or industries would give money and then they could get an earmark. But they also seem to make the machinery of Congress work better because you could actually get more things done. What's your take on if we bring back earmarks? Is that a good thing?
Well, this is,
I know it might be tough for you to say, but it, it also can help.
So I have a very particular kind of take on earmarks. You know, first of all, they never really did go away. Let's remember that. Okay. That's number one. They, you know, you have legislatively directed spending, you have letters that get sent. So this notion that they don't exist is a little bit of a myth. Second, there's a process that can be done very transparently and appropriately, which would be, if you are a member of Congress and you have a project in your district you want it funded, you go to the authorizing committee. You say to the authorizing committee, here's the case why we need a bridge in Albuquerque, New Mexico, which is where I'm from. And then, you know, that goes, you put your name to it. The committee votes on it. You know your district better than some, you know, person up in the executive branch knows. It goes through that process. It gets put in the authorizing bill. It goes to the appropriations bill. It decides whether to get funded. It's all transparent. Everybody knows who it is. Everybody knows what the funding level is. And that's called legislating. And the problem here, right, is that the transparency did not exist. The things were airdropped into appropriations bills. So if you go through, and I hate to kind of say the term regular order, because it means so much to different people, this is the legislative function. And that's, I think people have missed that part in terms of kind of the kind of radioactive term of earmarks.
But I would say it's important to think about earmarks in terms of the effect on the institution as it exists today. And I think a lot of people say it's a centralization of power issue, right? It's now who's to blame, for whatever, all the different reasons aside. The question is, will earmarks, if reintroduced today, reinforce the kind of current status quo of closed-door decision-making or not? Will they empower individual members or not? And I think what you find is that what earmarks will do is further, it will give the leadership, the committee chairs, whoever it is, that extra kind of tool, that one little extra thing to kind of compel the rank and file to vote certain ways, to act certain ways, not to be a rabble-rouser, not to challenge the system as it is. So the question, as I see it, of earmarks is not necessarily from a budgetary perspective or even necessarily a corruption perspective, although that certainly exists. It's what it does to the internal balance of power within the institution. I don't think there's any way outside of just if you offer an amendment and literally put it in a bill and they vote on it in the light of day, that's one thing. But if there's any kind of discretion, right, where it's in a committee report, or it's somehow just the committee like nodding at an administrator saying, hey, fund this grant first, then you're basically opening the door for the speaker, for the committee chair, for the majority leader to use that to say, hey, Mike Lee, hey, Elizabeth Warren, I know you don't like the way that we're doing things around here and your constituents want you to adjudicate this issue, but if you push forward on that vote, you're not going to get this earmark. I think that's inevitable, and that's what we saw during the first 4 years of the Bush administration, to be honest.
Jameson mentioned about chairs. When we talked on the phone yesterday, you talked about the cost of a chair. Like, can you, not an actual chair, but like, what, how much does it usually, like, do chairs raise, or they have to raise, or they, to get that, to become a powerful chair on a committee? And what is the public policy implications of kind of having that whole process play out?
Well, I would encourage everyone to go look at the Price of Power report on Issue One's website, in which we literally laid out what those costs were. If you're talking about eight committees, you're in the millions of dollars. And so everything from armed services to appropriations, the expectation that you will have raised, not only for your own, this is not your own reelect, right? This is money that you're raising for the party and for the other. You're in the two and three, this kind of, who knows what the number will be in this one. And the story that we told in this report is the story of education in the workforce, where the person that ended up with the chair in that committee was someone who had raised the most money and, in fact, had spent so much time dialing for dollars as a telemarketer, had her name put on the suite at the Republican congressional campaign booths. And there were members both of her party and others who said, if this had been done on merit, it was not clear in any way, shape, or form that this particular person would have been the committee chair. So there's actually, we got some requests from some members of Congress to say, what can we do about this? Is there a way to write a rule in which you could say that that whoever is determined to be the chair of committee, you could not take into account what they have done for an outside political party? There are ways and within rules to deal with some of this stuff. I would note we drafted that language, and it out there, it has not moved. But there are things that could be done.
I guarantee you that some of the freshman members who were elected, or freshman, congressmen-elect who were elected on Tuesday, that their people around them are telling them this week, saying, let's try to get on financial services, or how can we get on some of the best committees that you can have strong fundraising.
Yeah, the money makers. I mean, energy and commerce, is long known as the money maker, ways and means. I mean, these are, Veterans Affairs, not so much. These are just known, and some members, I would say Mitt Romney, for example, already has both a leadership pack and a joint fundraising committee as of yesterday.
And is that, how long have members been very keen to join certain committees? like in terms of factoring in fundraising? Is that, when did that start?
That started actually, I would blame, I'll say in my words, I would blame Tony Coelho for that. He was the head of the DCCC, and the Democrats had controlled the Congress for so many years. And when it started to be a little bit more up in question, he actually made a direct appeal to the corporate world to say, hey, we're in control of committees, you should give us the money because we're going to determine this. It used to be that, like, if you were in Mississippi, you wanted to be on armed services because you wanted to make sure that you had the bases that were in Mississippi protected. Or if you were in Montana, you had agriculture, so you wanted to be on the agriculture committee. But what happened in the 70s and then into the 80s was when the amounts of money exploded, and when this direct appeal to corporate America went to, that Tony Coelho actually very specifically said, we're in control of the committee. Yeah, you may feel like you're a Republican ideologically speaking, but you should actually give us the money, and we're going to go solicit you. We're going to make sure that we're going to keep a tally. And then, of course, Tom DeLay made it into a high art with this little notebook on his desk.
I wonder if Coelho has any like second thoughts about what that has led to today.
I think those are your first question. It's really disappointing, but I think it's also not surprising if you look at what the president said a few months ago after those indictments came down. It's that this is politically inconvenient for our party, and the Department of Justice should have known better. Basically, I'm paraphrasing, but you know, I think it's not surprising then when you hear the leader of the party saying, "Disregard these indictments; they're not legitimate because they're politically motivated." And Soren, what you said earlier, that politically motivated oversight is not necessarily a bad thing if there's merits there. And I think that's something that's being lost in this conversation. I think it's totally possible that congressional oversight and oversight for the Department of Justice even may have political undertones, but if there's merit there, we need to be able to take a step back and respect that merit. And I think the damage that's being done to the public discourse around that is really bad, and I don't have an answer to it, but I don't think it's surprising that those members won when that's the rhetoric and that's kind of what they're being, what the Republican Party is being told by their president.
And you had a Republican state lawmaker who was reelected, and he's in jail
right
on election day.
Right.
So.
One to die.
Yeah.
And yeah,
the
problem one that passed away.
Who was dead.
But it's not, it's not a new phenomenon.
Right.
I mean, Adam Clayton Powell, Ross Sinkowski, I mean, this happens. But that's why there actually is a provision in the Constitution that says the House has the power to determine its own membership, because the founders recognize that there is a democratic imperative that people have confidence in the Constitution, and recognize that sometimes when you in the House, right, particularly in the power of giving the people, the majority, that power, that sometimes it can either run amok or not end up with a result that protects the credibility of the institution. So that's why there's actually built into the Constitution this power for Congress to act to remove a duly elected.
Is that a majority vote? Or?
Yeah, I mean, at that point.
So would you expect Collins and Duncan Hunter to, with that?
In the past cases, either the members have resigned ahead of time, or if they've been a convict. And there's been a vote too. So
I just wonder in the Democratic House if that's going to be an issue.
Yeah, but usually it's many members have resigned, but in these cases where the members were indicted and still continue to run, I think you would probably be in the world looking for an actual conviction before the House would take any action.
I'm sure the panel next week will be great.
think it's a question of negative and positive agenda control. We long think of parties as being united, having stronger leaders. The divided parties today have stronger leaders. The reason why they're stronger is because their members need their leaders to keep these issues away from the agenda. So you have Paul Ryan telling moderate members not to bring up the discharge petition, going out of his way to try to kill it, because the courts will resolve that issue, right? You have McConnell filling the tree and acting just like Harry Reid did after lambasting Harry Reid on the floor repeatedly and criticizing him for that. And members are deferring. I mean, the thing is, at the end of the day, the members have all the power they want. They're the ones who are in control. They can change the situation whenever they want. All they have to do is act, especially in the Senate, but also the House, as the Freedom Caucus has demonstrated. John Boehner didn't retire voluntarily, and I think he saw the writing on the wall. He wouldn't have retired had Meadows not filed a motion to vacate the chair, right? And so, at the end of the day, the members have to be determined to act, but they're not determined to act, because I think they would prefer, especially in the Senate, to have this appearance of unity. And so it's a different kind of power, right? It's not that they don't have the power to do positive things, because they're unwilling to tolerate the divisions that come to the surface that would require. And that's the key difference. I mean, Mitch McConnell is not Mike Mansfield, and the reason why is that Mike Mansfield didn't see the Senate as a factory whose job it was to produce a widget. And he is the foreman of the factory. He controls everything. Mitch McConnell sees his job as coming in, turning on the lights, revving up the machines, opening the door, blowing the whistle, calling his employees in, and having them demand the production line, and then the widget comes out of the end. Well, guess what? When they don't agree on how that process should work, he just shuts it down. Because he doesn't want to have the foreman doesn't want to open it up and say, okay, well, what do you all think? Right? Because that then says that maybe the widget isn't a foregone conclusion. Maybe the process itself determines what the widget is. And all of a sudden, that's not a factory. That's politics. And that's the difference. We don't think of politics as a process of negotiation. We think of it as a production process. And in that environment, you get this weird kind of thing where leaders are both powerful and not powerful at the same time.
Yeah, and we have to remember that this was mostly the result of Gingrich, who came in and decided to consolidate power when they came in the 1990s. But that also was a reaction to what we saw in the 60s, where we had committee chairs in the Democratic side who were old Southerners who blocked almost all civil rights, who bottled up legislation for years and years. So, you know, it is a legislative process. There's not a perfect line here. I do think that this group of folks, whether it be the problem solvers, whether it be this, the kind of Congressional Reformers Caucus, the folks that are talking about process changes up on the Hill, there is interest in forming a select committee to kind of look at this, whether that's just a House committee or a joint committee is kind of an open question and largely depends on Mitch McConnell. But these are the kinds of questions that they want to struggle with, because there was a swing with Gingrich to say we're going to consolidate power as a reaction to the committee power before. So, it's always trying to find where that right place is that rank and file feel happy. But I would encourage all of you to go, if you're at all interested in this topic, there's a book called Class of 74. John Lawrence wrote. John was up on the Hill for many years. It talks about all the dissatisfaction in the early 1970s with members who felt like the rank and file weren't being listened to, et cetera. So these are issues that are somewhat endemic in the institution. It doesn't mean they shouldn't be dealt with or resolved and try and figure out the balance. But, what's right for this moment 10 years from now, 15 years from now, may not be the right one, which is why I think the work of our street, the work of these internal folks, the New America, all these groups. I wrote a letter with our street, New America, Norm Ornstein and Tom Mann a few years ago saying there should be the select committee, because we don't want to see the brain drain that we see up on the Hill. This is bad for democracy. We don't want to see staff that doesn't have the pay that they need to actually stay on the Hill. This is a system that empowers K Street. So these are really interesting conversations that the American people have no clue about.
I would add that a lot of the inflection points in these debates over the last 40, 50 years, frankly, have all been party internal, right? So the shift in who controls the House and the negotiation over what rules, and probably more likely when we pick a speaker post-Pelosi, are going to be key points about whether the Democrats open up some of these rules or not. I don't think that McConnell's changing anything, as James pointed out, but there could be scenarios in which that opens up some opportunity here. It's not clear to me the work's been done yet, you know, the sort of this side of the table, the sort of, you know, the civil society groups to make sure that that has the support. But I think that's really the key point. While the committee is important, often it's the House, it's the party rules, the caucus rules that make this change easy.
This gets to this larger psychological point that I was trying to make earlier, which is how we think about politics has changed. Because if you have a conception of happiness along the lines of what the framers had, the Greeks and everything, of public happiness, well, the job doesn't suck. You know what public happiness is? It's coming together and arguing with your peers and debating. And Adams and Jefferson are corresponding to the 1820s, and Jefferson writes Adams and he says, you know, it'll be great when we die that we can go to Congress and meet all of our ancient colleagues and we can have these great conversations and fights and arguments, right? Socrates says the exact same thing in Plato's Apology, where he says, you know what, I'm going to drink the hemlock, I'm not going to leave, because guess what, I get to go to Hades, and I get to meet, you know, Homer, and I get to argue with him, and I get to fight with him, and then that's public happiness, this notion of the public sphere, and what happens there is a noble and dignified thing, and that's where one is truly equal and truly free. That is the thing that we miss today. We see the public realm as a bad thing that needs to be dominated. And so then it makes no sense, of course, if you see it that way, that if you are then in the public realm, then you're going to be unhappy because you can't control politics. That's the whole point of freedom. And so if you have that conception, there's nothing you can do to make it a good thing to be there. You want to be ruling it. But that's not the way this whole thing works. So we need to change the way we think about politics if we truly want to fix our politics.
On that hopeful note, thank you so much for everyone to give us that last history lesson, and thank you for all for coming, and hope to see you at a future RSU event.
Thank you, RSU.